Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents The Elephant in the Universe, Our 100-Year Search for Dark Matter, by Govert Schilling, narrated by Joel Richards. The Blind Man and the Elephant, a Hindu Fable. It was six men of Indostan, to learning much inclined, who went to see the elephant, though all of them were blind, that each by observation might satisfy his mind. The first approached the elephant, and happening to fall against his broad and sturdy side, at once began to bawl, "God bless me, but the elephant is very like a wall." The second, feeling of the tusk, cried, "Ho, what have we here, so very round and smooth and sharp? To me 'tis mighty clear, this wonder of an elephant is very like a spear." The third approached the animal, and happening to take the squirming trunk within his hands, thus boldly up and spake, "I see," quoth he, "the elephant is very like a snake." The fourth reached out his eager hand and felt about the knee. "What most this wondrous beast is like is mighty plain," quoth he. "'Tis clear enough the elephant is very like a tree." The fifth, who chanced to touch the ear, said, "E'en the blindest man can tell what this resembles most. Deny the fact who can, this marvel of an elephant is very like a fan." The sixth no sooner had begun about the beast to grope, than seizing on the swinging tail that fell within his scope, "I see," quoth he, "the elephant is very like a rope." And so these men of Indostan disputed loud and long, each in his own opinion exceeding stiff and strong, though each was partly in the right, and all were in the wrong. So oft in theologic wars, the disputants, I ween, rail on in utter ignorance of what each other mean, and prate about an elephant not one of them has seen. John Godfrey Sachs, 1872. Foreword, Avi Loeb. The term dark matter is used to represent most of the matter in the universe, five times more prevalent than ordinary matter, like the atoms that make up stars and planets. But, as the name suggests, we cannot see dark matter. We infer its existence only indirectly through its gravitational influence on visible matter. In this way, dark matter encapsulates our ignorance. Like all good mysteries, the puzzle of dark matter is enduring. It has intrigued scientists for 100 years. Observations and scientific theories suggest that dark matter could be made of any number of hypothetical building blocks, weakly interacting massive particles, so-called axions, even atoms that do not interact with ordinary matter or light. Today there is a scientific consensus that dark matter likely came out of the fiery soup during the origins of the universe, an ocean of invisible particles with initially small random motions. Although scientists have not detected any of these invisible particles yet, they have measured the imprint of the fluctuations. Today, those dark matter fluctuations are evident in the slightly varied brightness of the cosmic microwave background, the relic radiation left over from the Big Bang. Lord Kelvin was the first to offer a dynamical estimate of what we now think of as dark matter. In a talk given in 1884, Kelvin theorized that there might be dark bodies in the Milky Way. Almost 50 years and many ideas later, Swiss-American astronomer Fritz Zwicky estimated that there is more mass in galaxy clusters than is visually observable. In the 1970s, evidence for invisible particles was revealed through the path-breaking work of Vera Rubin, Kent Ford, and Kenneth Freeman. They showed that the dynamics of gas and stars and galaxies imply the existence of invisible mass in a halo that extends well outside the inner region, where ordinary matter concentrates. And in 1983, Mati Milgram proposed a theory of modified Newtonian dynamics to explain the missing mass problem. In this alternative hypothesis of gravity, Milgram postulated that Newton's laws do not apply to galaxies. Like most explorations in science, historical theories of dark matter found supporters and critics. Milgram's simple prescription for modified dynamics at low accelerations accounts for the nearly flat rotation curves in many galaxy halos extremely well, even after four decades of scrutiny. But the theory does not adequately account for Zwicky's observed properties of galaxy clusters. Another possibility is that dark matter is strongly self-interacting and avoids galactic cores, and the hypotheses continue. Throughout this book, Govert Schilling leads us on a captivating tour through the theories of dark matter and efforts to observe it from early times to the present day. We'll travel with him to astronomical observatories on the ground and in space, and to particle detectors in underground caves and tunnels. As we circle the globe, we meet the scientists, the protagonists of the story, who have spent their careers searching for a solution to the puzzle. It is a wide-ranging cast of characters. There are towering figures in the field of dark matter research, like Jim Peebles and Jerry Ostreicher. There are younger scientists, true believers, skeptics, and heretics. Through their stories, we garner an extraordinary view into the past, present, and future of one of the deepest enigmas in science. As the elephant in the universe shows, the search for dark matter is a work in progress, hence the abundance of scientific interpretations. But one day, all of the pieces of the puzzle will fall into place. It is with Schilling's stellar guidance that we join leading scientists in their crusade to understand this unknown gravitating matter and, along the way, delight in the mysteries of our universe. Introduction. In 1995, astronomers announced that they had developed sensitive spectrometers that made it possible to precisely measure the velocities of stars. Within a few years, I reckoned, these tools would be used to discover extrasolar planets if the spectrometer picked up tiny periodic perturbations in the velocity of a star. Then there might be a massive planet nearby, the gravity of which was disrupting the parent star's movement through space. I decided to start researching a new book on the hunt for exoplanets, in the hope that the breakthrough find could be described in the closing chapter. In October of that same year, when Michel Mayor and Didier Queloz announced their discovery of 51 Pegasi b, the first confirmed planet beyond our solar system orbiting a sun-like star, I realized I had to hurry. For most of 1996, I worked on hardly anything else. My Dutch book, Tweeling Aard, Twin Earth, was published in early 1997. It was one of the first books to cover the initial round of extrasolar planet discoveries. Something similar happened about 20 years later. In early 2015, I began researching a book on gravitational waves, tiny undulations of the very fabric of the universe, caused by energetic events like colliding black holes. Albert Einstein's general theory of relativity predicted gravitational waves decades ago, and scientists have been hunting for them ever since. I knew as I started my research that advanced gravitational wave detectors would be going online in a matter of months. New versions of the Laser Interferometer Gravitational Wave Observatory in the United States and the Virgo detector in Italy. It looked like a discovery couldn't be more than a few years away. In fact, the first direct observation of gravitational waves came in September 2015 and was announced to the world in February of the following year. Again, I put everything aside to complete the book as soon as possible. Ripples in Space-Time was published in the summer of 2017. So when, in early 2018, I started seriously researching a new book on dark matter, I half-jokingly told the astrophysicists and particle physicists I was interviewing that I expected a revolutionary development in the field any day now. Wouldn't it be great if my book were the first to report on the long-awaited solution to the riddle of dark matter? the first to lay out what this mysterious stuff, said to constitute the balance of the cosmos, actually is? Unfortunately, it didn't happen. So here's the spoiler. When you reach the end of this book, you still won't know what most of the material universe is made of, but neither do scientists. Despite decades of speculation, searching, studies, and simulations, dark matter remains one of the biggest enigmas of modern science. Still, after listening to this book, you will have learned a lot about the miraculous universe we live in, and about the ways in which astronomers and physicists have teased out its secrets. Dark matter challenges our imagination. Like some invisible glue, it is what holds the universe together and what makes it tick. Without it, galaxies would fall apart, galaxy clusters would dissolve, and space would have expanded into oblivion long ago. Dark matter is the most important stuff out there. Yet we've only found out about it in recent decades, and no one has a clue as to its true nature. Well, at least we've learned what it's not, thanks to the work of hundreds of dedicated scientists. Dark matter is not an ocean of ultra-dim dwarf stars. It is not an all-pervading veil of murky gas and intergalactic space. Dark matter is not a population of black holes, at least not the regular kind that astronomers are slowly starting to explore. Dark matter isn't even composed of the atoms and molecules that we're familiar with. It's something weird and exotic altogether. And it has shaped the universe we live in. Dark matter provided the scaffolding for the growth of cosmic structure. It enabled the formation of galaxy clusters, galaxies, stars, planets, and eventually people. However, despite the numerous disciplines and scientists that are involved in studying the problem, we don't seem to be able to really solve it. There have been hints and allegations, circumstantial evidence and wishful thinking, but so far, not a single convincing detection, no hint of dark matter's true identity. The story of the search for dark matter goes back to the 1930s. Although the mystery wasn't generally acknowledged until some 50 years ago, when astronomers started to wonder about the high rotational velocities of the outer parts of spiral galaxies, like our own Milky Way. Before long, particle physicists got involved, as it became evident that the puzzle couldn't be solved without invoking a completely new form of matter. And because of its pivotal role in the evolution of the universe, this new dark matter also turned into a hot topic in cosmology, the study of the universe at the largest possible scales. Dark matter is a genuinely multidisciplinary area of research that has kept observers, theoreticians, experimentalists, and computer model builders busy for decades. With so many people working on the problem over such a long time, it's outright impossible to do everyone justice in a book like this. After all, The Elephant in the Universe is not a technical book, nor does it pretend to be the definitive history of the field. Instead, this book provides a broad view of dark matter research in all its bewildering variety. Personal stories of many key players give a taste of the ingenuity, perseverance, and sometimes stubbornness of scientists who have devoted their professional lives to solving nature's biggest mysteries. I'll take you, the listener, along to remote astronomical observatories and underground laboratories. We'll attend scientific conferences and talk with Nobel laureates and postdoc researchers alike. Unfortunately, due to the COVID-19 pandemic, not all of my planned trips could be realized, and quite a number of interviews had to be conducted on the phone or via Zoom. Our journey covers a wide range of dark matter-related topics. Although most of the 25 chapters could be read as standalone stories, I've arranged them in an order that presents the scope of the mystery and shows how that mystery has evolved. To set the stage, the first chapter introduces physicist James Peebles, who has been called the father of the popular cold dark matter, CDM model, and who was the co-recipient of the 2019 Nobel Prize in Physics for his contributions to theoretical cosmology. Next, in Chapter 2, a visit to the underground Gran Sasso Laboratory in Italy gives a preliminary taste of the experimental approach to the dark matter riddle. Dark matter isn't the exclusive province of computer simulations and conference papers. At this very moment, dozens of scientists all over the world are putting theory to the test in hopes of solving this puzzle. After whetting your appetite by means of this introductory brush with theory and experiment, we travel a century back in time in Chapter 3 to learn about the first indications that something was amiss in our understanding of the material contents of the universe. Much later, in the 1970s, physicists realized that galaxies like our own Milky Way cannot be stable without huge, more or less spherical halos of dark matter. Pioneers like astronomer Vera Rubin started to realize that the high spin rates of galaxies can only be explained if they contain much more than meets the eye, as described in Chapter 5. Today, Rubin's name adorns a brand new telescope under construction. When completed, it will be one of the most powerful on Earth, an instrument central to scientists' attempts to map the three-dimensional distribution of galaxies in space. That project is an important dimension of dark matter research and the subject of Chapter 6. Then, in Chapter 7, we delve into the origin of the elements, only to discover why dark matter cannot consist of ordinary atoms and molecules. The decisive role of radio astronomy in proving that dark matter really exists is the topic of Chapter 8. This concludes the first part of the book, which is largely focused on astronomical research. Part 2 opens with two chapters discussing the growing conviction in the second half of the 1970s that the mysterious stuff must be composed of relatively slow-moving, cold, elementary particles. Such particles fit remarkably well in the theory of supersymmetry, a promising candidate for the long-sought theory of everything. Thus, dark matter started to play an important role in particle physics, too. Chapter 11 details computer simulations of the evolution of the large-scale structure of the universe, which seem to support a candidate for the contents of dark matter, weakly interacting massive particles, or WIMPs. But just as the WIMP hypothesis was emerging, some scientists began to doubt that dark matter is real. Their theory of modified Newtonian dynamics, MOND, discussed in Chapter 12, claims that our understanding of gravity needs revision. Dark matter hunters may be chasing a chimera after all. In Chapters 13 and 14, we encounter the powerful observational technique of gravitational lensing, the minute deflection of light by the gravity of massive objects. Gravitational lensing was recognized for its potential to rebut the MOND theory and help scientists find an alternative dark matter candidate known as massive compact halo objects, or MACHOs. Alas, the hunt for MACHOs came up all but empty. Instead, another mystery revealed itself in the late 1990s, dark energy. Scientists realized that empty space was expanding at an accelerating rate, a direct result of dark energy. That discovery, and what it might imply for the overall composition of the universe, are the topics of chapters 15 and 16. Dark energy and the cold dark matter theory have been integrated into a single cosmological model known as Lambda CDM, where the Greek letter lambda denotes dark energy. Studies of the cosmic microwave background, sometimes called the afterglow of creation, provide strong supporting evidence for the model. Moreover, as described in Chapter 17, the relic radiation can be compared to the current large-scale structure of the universe to provide a detailed view of cosmic evolution, in which dark matter plays an unmistakable role. Even though we still don't know what dark matter is, we've come to realize that it is a key ingredient of cosmology. Part 3 concerns current and future searches for dark matter, as well as some of the challenges facing today's cosmologists. In chapters 18 and 19, you'll hear about high-tech experiments that seek to detect dark matter particles directly, using ultra-sensitive instruments installed in deep caves and tunnels, which shield the instruments from cosmic rays that would otherwise disturb the measurements. Surprisingly, cosmic rays themselves may carry telltale fingerprints of decaying dark matter particles, the topic of Chapter 20. Chapters 21 and 22 describe a number of worrisome issues that have lately arisen with respect to the Lambda CDM model. As yet, no one knows how serious these problems are, but theorists are already exploring a range of alternative ideas and hypotheses, some of which are presented in chapters 23 and 24. The closing chapter looks ahead, but it is impossible to predict which of the future experiments and observatories will finally solve the century-old mystery of dark matter. Let's just hope it doesn't take another 100 years. As a science journalist, specializing in everything beyond the Earth's atmosphere, I have probably focused a bit more strongly on astronomy than on particle physics, although I've tried to achieve a good balance between the two. I also put more emphasis on past developments, well-established ideas, and current experiments than on new speculative theories, unconfirmed results, and possible future experiments. If these novelties are here to stay, you will undoubtedly read about them in a future book. The dark matter hunt continues, but though it is unfinished, it has already brought us a deeper understanding of a wide range of astronomical and physical phenomena, from fast-spinning galaxies, gravitational lensing, and the large-scale structure of the universe to the birth of atomic nuclei and the Big Bang, and telltale patterns in the afterglow of creation. The search has also spawned other promising theories, fueling speculations about supersymmetry and as-yet-undiscovered denizens of the particle zoo. While searching for the true identity of the bulk of the universe, scientists have unlocked some of nature's most closely held secrets and revealed the stunning complexity of the world we are an integral part of. Part 1. Ear. 1. Matter, but not as we know it. Philip James Edwin Peebles, the Albert Einstein Professor Emeritus of Science at Princeton University, Fellow of the American Physical Society and the Royal Society, 2019 Nobel Laureate in Physics, and godfather of the theory of cold dark matter, slowly stands up from his desk and walks toward a bookshelf on the opposite wall, where he picks up 2 empty plastic bottles. He blows air over the opening of the larger one. A low, trembling sound fills the room. Next, he puts the smaller bottle to his lips. Another sound, at a much higher pitch. "It's the same principle," Peebles says, with a characteristically meek smile on his face. "Every size has its own favorite frequency, and vice versa." "Now wait a minute. Something that simple doesn't earn you a Nobel Prize, right?" "Well, it does if you successfully apply it to sound waves in the newborn universe. If you help prove that galaxies can't be stable without loads of mysterious dark matter, and if you then lay the basis for our current standard model of cosmology." Thus, at 5 a.m. on Tuesday, October 8, 2019, Peebles got the magic phone call from the Swedish Academy of Sciences. He shared the prize with 2 others but received half of the prize money, totaling some $910,000, for theoretical discoveries in physical cosmology. "Good God," his wife Allison said when she heard the news. Then Peebles made the daily 1-mile walk from his home to his office on the 2nd floor of Jadwin Hall, his 84-year-old head full of jumbled thoughts. You know, Jim Peebles had never imagined that he would become a cosmologist. Born in 1935 in the Canadian city of St. Boniface, now part of metropolitan Winnipeg, little Jimmy was a tinkerer, a would-be gyro-gearloose, who studied the pages of Mechanics Illustrated, built electrical contraptions, experimented with gunpowder, and fell in love with steam locomotives. Oh yes, he'd go out when the Northern Lights would perform their silent dance in the Manitoba winter sky, and sure, he knew how to find the pole star. But astronomy never really captured his tech-savvy mind. When he first learned about cosmology as a graduate student, he found it exceedingly dull and ad hoc and unbelievable, as he once told astronomer Martin Harwit. That slowly changed after he arrived at Princeton in the fall of 1958. Peebles was a PhD student in the research group of the brilliant physicist Robert Dicke. On Friday evenings, Dicke organized seminars where students, postdocs, and professors freely discussed every scientific topic that piqued their interest. Intimidated at first by other people's grasp of quantum physics or general relativity, Peebles came to cherish these informal meetings, and not only for the occasional beer drinking afterwards. Dicke's preoccupation with cosmology turned out to be contagious. In 1962, Peebles completed his thesis on the question of whether the strength of the electromagnetic force varies over time. He remained at Princeton as a postdoc, collaborating with Dicke and two other postdocs, David Wilkinson and Peter Roll. In a washed-out 1960s photograph that he showed during his Nobel lecture, Peebles looks tall and slim, with dark straight hair, spectacles, and an Icelandic sweater. There was a lot of distance between graduate school and the black tie affair in Stockholm. Peebles' career as a physical cosmologist was launched on a sweltering day in the summer of 1964. In the stuffy attic of the Palmer Physical Laboratory at Princeton, Dicke unfolded his ambitious plans to search for the radiation left over from the newborn universe, a primordial conflagration millions of degrees hotter than any attic. Scientists expected that radiation from this long-ago event was out there, if only it could be found. Wilkinson and Roll were charged with building the equipment necessary to detect the radiation. "So, Jim," Dicke said, "why don't you delve into the theory behind all this?" Peebles worked out how the hot plasma of the early expanding universe, a mix of electrically charged particles, would have interacted with the energetic radiation to form a dense, viscous fluid, sloshing and vibrating with low-frequency sound waves, like a primeval broth. Then, some 380,000 years after the Big Bang, when temperatures had dropped enough for neutral atoms to form, matter and radiation became decoupled. No longer did the properties of one command the behavior of the other. And while the radiation could now freely propagate throughout the universe, cooling down to become the faint cosmic background glow that Dicke was after, the matter was left behind with a pattern of over and under densities, regions in which the density was just a tiny bit higher or lower than average, with dimensions determined by the frequencies of the original sound waves. Size relates to frequency, and vice versa, as Peebles playfully demonstrated with his plastic bottles turned musical instruments. The same principle applies to the universe at large, producing that telltale pattern, which physicists call baryon acoustic oscillations. Over time, matter in overdense regions would further condense into galaxies. This is the reason that galaxies exhibit a non-random distribution in three-dimensional space. They tend to show up where the early acoustic waves left the densest deposits of matter. In other words, the current large-scale structure of the universe is set by events that took place shortly after the Big Bang. It's complicated stuff, and you may forget it for now. We'll get back to baryon acoustic oscillations in Chapter 17. Suffice it to say, around his 30th birthday, Jim Peebles developed a knack for thinking the grandest possible thoughts. Maybe not about life, but certainly about the universe and everything. You don't need to be 42 for that. Peebles wasn't even distressed by the fact that radio engineers Arno Penzias and Robert Wilson beat the Princeton group in detecting the cosmic background radiation. From their perch at Bell Laboratories in nearby Holmdel, New Jersey, Penzias and Wilson made the discovery in 1964, just a few months after Dickey convened his team. "Well, boys, I think we've been scooped," a disappointed Dickey told them after he got the phone call about the discovery. But Peebles remembers having felt excited. The discovery meant that he and his colleagues were not engaged in mere speculation. There actually was something out there to be studied. Peebles had caught the cosmology bug, and he has had it ever since. Soon enough, he was lecturing on a topic that once had seemed exceedingly dull and unbelievable. His book, Physical Cosmology, was published in the fall of 1971, a year before he became a full professor. The first edition sits prominently on the bookshelf next to his desk, close to an Albert Einstein action figure. Physical cosmology. For centuries, no, for millennia, the origin and evolution of the universe as a whole had been treated as something metaphysical. A universe resting on the backs of elephants and giant turtles, a divine act of creation in the not-too-distant past. But finally, the mythological mists began to clear. The sacred stories made way for scientific scrutiny and physical investigation. Cosmology became something you could touch, take apart, understand, marvel at, even fall in love with, like a steam locomotive. Fast forward half a century, and Nobel laureate Philip James Edwin Peebles, his tall body casually clad in blue jeans and a moss-green sweater, bends over his computer monitor, takes off his glasses to discern the tiny characters on the screen, searches through archived scientific papers, loses himself in historical detail. So much has happened in the past five decades. So many breakthrough discoveries. So many dead ends. So many riddles. But most of all, the gradual realization that our universe, our very existence, is governed by a mysterious substance. By enigmatic stuff that, for lack of a better understanding, goes by the name of dark matter. To paraphrase Star Trek, it's matter, Jim, but not as we know it. Yes, there had been early hints, back in the 1930s. But it wasn't until the 1970s and early 1980s that dark matter burst onto the scene, like a surprise protagonist who doesn't appear until the third act, and then dramatically changes the plot of the play. There are more things in heaven and earth, Horatio, than are dreamt of in your philosophy. The details will have to wait. But there were numerous findings that only made sense in a universe filled with dark matter. Peebles' own research on the clustered distribution of galaxies in space, carried out before astronomers were able to create reliable three-dimensional maps, was suggestive. His theoretical work, together with Princeton colleague Jeremiah Ostreicher, seemed to indicate that the stability of disk galaxies was impossible unless they're surrounded by massive halos of dark matter. Not much later, Vera Rubin and Kent Ford of the Carnegie Institution of Washington became the first to convincingly show, or were they, that the outer parts of galaxies rotate much faster than they would in the absence of dark matter. And there were ever more detailed observations of the cosmic microwave background radiation, the remnant radiation from the newborn universe, revealing that it was as smooth as a baby's skin. It was this unexpected result that led Peebles, in 1982, to propose his cold dark matter model. Here's the problem. Either the hot plasma of the early universe was too smoothly distributed, or the current large-scale structure of the cosmos is too lumpy. You can't have your cake and eat it too. The feeble force of gravity, acting in an ever-expanding universe, never gets you from the smooth there and then to the lumpy here and now. Unless. unless dark matter is something really weird. A new type of particle, responsive to gravity, but not to other fundamental forces of nature, like electromagnetism or the strong nuclear force. Not coupled to the early universe's hot radiation bath at all. Moving slowly enough, cold enough in particle physics parlance, to start clustering into what would become an invisible scaffolding, well before the cosmic background radiation was released. A cosmic cobweb of unfamiliar stuff that subsequently pulled in old-fashioned ordinary atoms, which went on to form the luminous galaxies and clusters that we see today. Cold dark matter. Theoretical discoveries in physical cosmology, that's what half of the 2019 Nobel Prize in Physics was awarded for. Sure enough, in the 4 decades since Peebles proposed cold dark matter, the theory became hot and illuminating, extremely productive, and an integral part of what is now known as the concordance model of cosmology. Another key ingredient of this model is dark energy, which is no less mysterious than dark matter and will be discussed in Chapter 16. But Peebles is not the person to brag about it. He feels he has every reason to be modest. First of all, he says, theoretical discoveries rank second after real discoveries. The other half of the 2019 Physics Nobel went to astronomers Michel Mayor and Didier Queloz, the pair who in 1995 found the first planet beyond our solar system orbiting a sun-like star. Now that's a discovery. Or what about the Higgs particle found in 2012? Gravitational waves, 2015. Those were singular events in which scientists confirmed what was otherwise just extremely well-informed speculation. The theory of cold dark matter is nothing like that. Second, Peebles was, at least for a while, less invested in his theory than were other physicists. Especially when the cold dark matter model was in its younger days, he felt uneasy about cosmologists' enthusiastic embrace. Personally, he didn't take the model that seriously, not back then. "Hey guys, I'm just trying to solve the smoothness problem, and this is the simplest model I can think of that fits the observations. What makes you think this is right? I could make other models too." In fact, he did. Some of those other models didn't need dark matter at all. Granted, the other models didn't stand the test of time. Cold dark matter did. Third, Peebles recognizes the limitations of his model. We may have this wonderful theory, this concordance model that explains both the properties of the cosmic background radiation and the distribution of galaxies in the universe. But it's full of holes. As Peebles explained it to me, dark matter is a kind of kludge. We are stuck with this ridiculous stuff that we had to dream up and install by hand into our understanding of the universe. We need dark matter, but we don't know what it is. There are just too many open questions. Which is not to say that we don't know anything about dark matter. Its fingerprints are all over the place. We will encounter them one by one later in the book. And by studying how the mysterious stuff affects its surroundings, we've at least made some progress toward understanding its characteristics. Still, at times it seems weird and unbelievable. It's not that surprising to find something new in the heavens, but how could we have missed 85% of all the gravitating stuff out there, as dark matter scientists claim? Didn't we just put it in by hand, as Peebles told me, to explain our observations? All those astrophysical fingerprints may constitute convincing evidence, but how much longer are we prepared to wait for the irrefutable detection? How contrived is our solution? How hypothetical our theory? What if dark matter doesn't exist after all? I'll confess, every now and then I find myself in a doubtful mode. Dark matter, dark energy, the enigmatic inflationary birth of the universe, the multiverse, for goodness sake. It all seems too far-fetched, too made up. Nature can't be that crazy and cunning and cruel, can it? Or is it just my lack of imagination? The inability to accept that nature is not obliged to meet my expectations. Am I like Peter Pan, who doesn't want to grow up and keeps believing in Tinkerbell, in the simple, understandable universe that I learned about when I was a child? The thing is, I'm not appalled at all by Einstein's general theory of relativity, although I don't fully understand it, or by the existence of neutrinos, to give just two examples. Had I lived in the 19th century and heard about relativity and its implications, black holes, gravitational waves, space getting warped and time slowing down, would I have believed any of it without convincing proof? If someone had told me that zillions of uncharged, almost massless particles, that is, neutrinos, pass through my body at light speed every single second, wouldn't I have burst out in laughter? But Einstein's 1915 theory was confirmed 4 years later, and neutrinos were first detected in 1956, the year I was born. Both belong to the universe I grew up with, the universe I've come to accept. As for the newer and equally counterintuitive fads of nature, maybe I'm just too conservative. Yet we need to be cautious. Scientists have been wrong before. Frequently, in fact. The road to a better and more complete understanding of the universe is littered with discarded theories and wrong assumptions that have stuck around longer than they should have. The reason is that scientists are a conservative lot. Even in the face of contradictory evidence, they'd rather tweak an existing theory to accommodate the conflicting data than throw it in the dustbin. Unless an even more successful theory comes along, that is. For instance, for a long time after 17th century Dutch physicist Christian Huygens published his wave theory of light, scientists assumed that empty space must be filled by something known as the ether, the medium in which light waves were said to propagate. When later experiments contradicted the first simple ideas about this mysterious substance, physicists didn't discard the concept, but adapted it to better agree with the observations. Eventually, they had painted themselves into an uncanny corner in which the ether had to be an infinite, transparent, massless, non-viscous, yet incredibly rigid fluid. Only when Einstein's 1905 theory of special relativity rendered the magical ether superfluous did scientists abolish it. Something similar occurred in the late 18th century when chemists reluctantly had to agree that there was no such thing as phlogiston. This fire-like element was thought to be released by some substances when they combusted. A substance could burn only as long as it could release phlogiston. The fact that fires died when starved of air was understood to mean that a given quantity of air could absorb only so much phlogiston. The attractive idea was promoted around the year 1700 by the German chemist Georg Stahl and had a large following, even when experiments revealed that some metals, like magnesium, became heavier upon burning. A bizarre finding given that, according to the theory, some of its matter was necessarily released. Phlogiston proponents simply concluded that the mysterious stuff must have negative weight. They finally gave in when, in 1783, French chemist Antoine Lavoisier convincingly showed that combustion is a chemical process requiring oxygen, an element whose properties were only then becoming known. Finally, I can't resist mentioning the best-known example of scientists betting on the wrong horse. Ptolemy's theory of epicycles. Starting from two very plausible assumptions, at least for the ancient Greeks, namely that Earth is at the center of the universe and that the heavenly bodies move in perfect circles and at constant velocities, Ptolemy came up with his clever geocentric worldview. According to the second century scholar, a planet moves in a small circle, an epicycle, whose empty center orbits the Earth in a much larger circle, called a deferent. To comport with the observed motions of the planets in the sky, Ptolemy's model needed a large number of epicycles, plus further contrivances, like an arbitrary offset of a deferent center from the Earth. Nevertheless, the complicated and cumbersome model survived for no fewer than 14 centuries, until Nicholas Copernicus and Johannes Kepler finally gave us the current heliocentric worldview, in which the planets move at varying speeds along elliptical orbits around the Sun. So there we are. We've never actually seen dark matter, but we think it must exist. Yet we should always be aware of the silent assumptions that go into our arguments and be concerned about the number of fixes and tweaks that we're allowing ourselves to introduce with no other goal than to keep our theoretical plates spinning. We don't want to be led astray by epicycles again, do we? It's an unnerving thought. Either there's loads of dark matter out there, frustratingly successful in escaping detection by today's ultra-sensitive instruments, or all these diligent scientists are chasing a phantom. Jim Peebles isn't confident that we will ever find a final, definitive answer when it comes to dark matter, or indeed a theory of everything. And even if we arrive at such an all-encompassing description of nature, he says, it's not guaranteed that we'll be able to check it against the real universe. Why should nature give us any evidence at all? Sure, in the past we have been successful in finding the evidence we need to prove and disprove theories, but that could well change in the future. Perhaps we will hit some limit at which the evidence needed is impossible to obtain. It's a thought that worries him every now and then. The horrible possibility that we will end up with a totally internally consistent theory that we cannot test. Alas, there's no guarantee that that won't happen. No, Peebles is not too discouraged by the fact that he may not live to witness the solution of the dark matter riddle. In his Nobel lecture, he told the audience, "I'm happy to pass on to a younger generation many interesting research questions that I have not been able to solve." 2 months earlier, in an interview with Adam Smith, the editor-in-chief of the Nobel Prize website, Peebles expressed hope that this younger generation will be surprised by what is found to be the nature of dark matter. "That is my romantic dream, that we will be surprised yet once again." At astronomical observatories, in particle physics labs, and in space science institutes all over the planet, many hundreds of young, brilliant scientists are working hard to make Jim Peebles' romantic dream come true. They are not just ready to be surprised, but eager. It sure looks like dark matter is here to stay. Now we want to know what it is. 2. Underground Phantoms. Junji Naganoma sits at his desk, studying graphs and numbers on his computer monitor. Business as usual, you might think. But this is not your average office. The desk is surrounded by racks, crates, and piles of boxes. Naganoma is wearing a safety helmet and a parka. It's 50 degrees Fahrenheit at most, and there's no daylight. His office is a 100-meter-long cave, dimly lit by floodlights on the damp walls, lined with pipes and cables. Huge pieces of equipment, their function unintelligible just by looking, are arranged here and there. Service tunnels, wide enough for trucks to drive through, connect the cave to two others of similar size. The whole complex sits beneath almost a mile of rock in the Italian Apennines. "Welcome to the Laboratori Nazionali del Gran Sasso, the largest underground physics laboratory in the world." In Hall B, scientists and technicians from 24 countries are constructing Xenon NT, the latest and most sensitive version of their experiment to directly detect dark matter particles. Naganoma, a postdoc from Japan, is checking test results from a makeshift clean room. The boxes contain dozens of fragile photomultiplier tubes, manufactured by a German university, ready to install. During my visit in late 2019, Xenon NT is nearing completion. By the time you're listening to this, it is actively collecting data in pursuit of invisible stuff. Astronomy has a long history of finding new things that we knew nothing about before. Over time, especially after the invention of the telescope just over 4 centuries ago, our cosmic inventory has become longer and longer. Astronomers discovered moons orbiting Jupiter, planets in the outer solar system, zillions of stars, interstellar gas clouds, and countless galaxies resembling our own Milky Way. But all these cosmic denizens can be seen either with a classical optical telescope or with instruments that detect X-rays, ultraviolet light, or radio waves, frequencies of light imperceptible to the human eye, but which can be discerned by specially designed cameras. Finding invisible stuff is different. Invisible stuff can be found only if it leaves some kind of mark on its visible surroundings by influencing the properties or behavior of those surroundings. The contents of a sealed cardboard box in my attic are invisible, but I know they're in there because they make the box heavier and harder to move around. A magnet out of view under a table creates telltale patterns in iron filings on the tabletop. Griffin, the aptly named protagonist of H.G. Wells' 1897 science fiction novel, The Invisible Man, leaves footprints in the mud for all to see. As the saying goes, there's more than meets the eye. In the wider universe, it's usually gravity that does the influencing, that leaves the mark and thereby suggests to researchers the presence of something invisible. The effects of gravity are fairly easy to distinguish because gravity is unique in the universe. It is the only long-range force in nature that is always attractive. The more mass, the more gravity, the stronger the effect. In contrast, the electromagnetic force, acting on charged particles, can both be attractive and repulsive, and on larger scales, the effects usually cancel out. Gravity governs the motions of the planets, the structure of galaxies, and the evolution of the universe as a whole. And, of course, the way apples fall down from trees. As Isaac Newton noted while retiring in his family garden some years before he formulated his law of universal gravitation in 1687. Just by studying the effects of gravity, astronomers got on the trail of the planet Neptune, of the white dwarf companion of the star Sirius, of extrasolar planets, and of the supermassive black hole in the center of our Milky Way galaxy. Like the invisible griffin, all these objects left their gravitational footprints in the mud, thus betraying their very existence. What if you see the marks in the mud, but fail to identify the invisible man? Never mind, you know he must be there, and by closely studying his footprints, you may be able to learn quite a bit about him. Take exoplanets, for example. From their observations, astronomers can deduce a planet's orbital period, the planet's distance from its parent star, and hence the planet's temperature, and even an indication of the planet's mass. You don't need to actually see the planet. Measuring its gravitational influence alone is enough. At the Gran Sasso Laboratory, too, scientists try to learn about invisible stuff by studying an observable fingerprint. In this case, however, the fingerprint isn't produced by gravity. The cave-bound researchers are looking for dark matter particles, which, if they exist, certainly have mass, but cannot be detected on the basis of their gravitational influence. At the scale of individual particles, gravity is feeble. Gravity's effects only manifest at large scales, when the attractive forces of big collections of particles add up. So a single dark matter particle will never exert enough gravitational attraction to become apparent on that basis alone. But since particles, including putative dark matter particles, have mass, such particles will have oomph. Therefore, it may be possible to spot them individually through their extremely rare collisions with nuclei of normal matter, like xenon, the element the scientists at Gran Sasso are using. An interaction between a dark matter particle and a xenon nucleus will produce a tiny flash of light, and it is this flash that scientists hope to detect. Hence the photomultiplier tubes. Experiments like Gran Sasso's face a bit of a snag, though. The problem is that the same flash of light occurs when an atom is hit by less mysterious subatomic bullets, collectively known as cosmic ray particles. Cosmic rays are energetic messengers from outer space. Most of them are protons, the nuclei of hydrogen atoms. Upon entering Earth's atmosphere, they collide with atoms and molecules of nitrogen and oxygen before reaching the surface of our planet. The result is an air shower of secondary particles that reach the surface. If you're looking for dark matter interactions, these secondary cosmic ray particles are a source of experimental noise. And, as we all know, in a noisy environment, it's hard to hear a pin drop. That's where the Apennine limestone comes in. While dark matter easily passes through a mile of rock, after all, the weird stuff rarely interacts with normal matter, or we would have detected it a long time ago, most of the secondary cosmic ray particles, mainly negatively charged muons, are effectively stopped. As far as particle interactions go, the Gran Sasso lab is extremely silent. Great. But how do you fund, build, and manage an underground lab as large as a medieval cathedral? Back in 1980, nuclear physicist Antonino Zucchi knew which strings to pull. Italian politicians were contemplating the construction of a highway tunnel beneath the Apennines, providing a fast connection between Rome on the shores of the Tyrrhenian Sea and the Adriatic on the east coast. Zucchi, who was president of the Italian Institute of Nuclear Physics, INFN, at the time, suggested excavating just a little bit more. A large subterranean physics laboratory adjacent to the tunnel would establish Italy's leading position in the field. It all worked out as Zucchi had hoped. The tunnel was completed in 1984, and the INFN lab was established the following year. By 1989, the first underground experiment was running, looking, unfortunately without success, for magnetic monopoles, weird hypothetical particles left over from the Big Bang. Over the subsequent years, the facility was expanded to a staggering volume of 180,000 cubic meters. Its experiments run by some 1,100 scientists from all over the world. The Gran Sasso Tunnel lies just east of the medieval city of L'Aquila, the Eagle, the capital of Italy's Abruzzo region. Autostrada 24 winds its way from Rome to L'Aquila through an enchanting landscape, traversing so many national parks and nature reserves that it's also known as the Strada dei Parchi. But upon entering L'Aquila, I am painfully reminded that natural beauty comes at a price. The Apennine Mountains, the geological spine of Italy, are prone to earthquakes, and large parts of the iconic city center were destroyed by a magnitude 6.3 terremoto in the early morning hours of April 6, 2009, killing over 300 people. L'Aquila is only slowly recovering. The skyline is dominated by building cranes, but many centuries-old churches await full restoration. The steep cobblestone streets are filled with concrete mixers, wheelbarrows, and the sound of clanging and hammering. Pylons and barrier tape are everywhere. Most houses are wrapped in scaffolding and debris netting. It's a depressing sight, and I can hardly imagine the perseverance and determination required to rebuild a city, only to await the inevitable next quake. Suddenly, the persistence of particle physicists hunting for dark matter appears futile and luxurious in comparison. Close to L'Aquila's landmark Fontana Luminosa, an illuminated fountain topped by two bronze female nudes, Auk Peter Collein picks me up to drive the remaining 10 kilometers or so to the lab's above-ground offices, on the western slope of the Grand Sasso Massif. Colline is the technical coordinator for Xenon NT. He is also the one who came up with the experiment's strange moniker. Grand Sasso's previous dark matter experiment used approximately 1 ton of liquid xenon as a dark matter detector, so it was called Xenon 1T. But the amount of xenon in the new experiment remained undecided for quite a while, so Colline suggested the name Xenon NT, where N stands for any number. The experiment's xenon load ended up being 8 tons, but the nerdy name stuck. A tall, lean, and easygoing physicist in his late 40s, Colline divides his time between the Dutch National Institute for Subatomic Physics, the universities of Amsterdam and Utrecht, and Grand Sasso. In Italy, most of his colleagues know him simply as AP, because his Dutch name is so hard to pronounce. After Colline and I make a brief visit to the lab's external facilities, as they are known, a loose collection of offices and workshops, and a canteen that serves terrific espresso, we hit the A24 again to enter the Traforo del Gran Sasso eastbound. Minutes later, we're beneath 1,400 meters of solid rock, safely shielded from noisy cosmic ray particles. But wait, where's the lab? It's on the north side of the highway, Colline tells me, only accessible from the westbound tunnel. He follows an exit to the Nerd Roundabout, the only way back to the tunnel and the entrance of the underground facility. A pretty frustrating detour if you forget your screwdriver, he quips. After passing a security gate and parking the car, we begin our cave walk, wearing sturdy shoes and safety helmets. So this is where physicists hope to solve the dark matter mystery, I tell myself. If their theories are right, the phantom particles are all around us. It's just a matter of catching them. It's unexpectedly quiet in the three immense caverns, which are oriented perpendicular to the highway tunnel. On average, 2 dozen people may be working underground at any given time. But the place is so overwhelmingly large that you hardly notice them. Each dusky hall is about 100 meters long, 20 meters wide, and 18 meters high. Wherever you go, there's a soft hum of equipment and machinery, punctuated by the occasional louder rumbling of huge ventilators and air conditioners. There is more to Grand Sasso than Xenon NT. We work our way around the tanks of the Boric Xeno experiment and stand in awe in front of the large volume detector. These are two giant facilities for the study of neutrinos, elusive, uncharged, subatomic particles that may play a key role in solving the mystery of dark matter. We pass a host of other physics experiments, some modest in size, others as large as a house, bearing contrived acronymic names like Cupid, VIP, Cobra, and Gerda. They're all devotedly going about their business. A hissing valve here, a vibrating needle dial there, racks of computer equipment and flickering control LEDs everywhere. With its incomprehensible equipment, eerie atmosphere, and uncanny desolation, the underground lab feels like an abandoned alien freight ship, or the post-apocalyptic remains of a secret military base. Indeed, what will future archaeologists make of our goals and motives when they hit upon this strange place thousands of years from now? Finally, we arrive at the site of Xenon NT in Hall B. I have seen the pictures, but that doesn't make the experiment less impressive. Immediately next to a huge cylindrical tank is the eye-catching, rectangular, three-story control building with its futuristic glass walls. A staircase rises on one face of the control building, while the opposite side abuts the tank. The glass structure seems as transparent as the universe is to dark matter itself. Cryogenic equipment, used to keep the liquid xenon at its low temperature of negative 95 degrees Celsius, is stored on the top level, The control room and data acquisition systems are on the second level, and xenon storage and purification instruments are on the ground floor. All part of this effort to detect mysterious stuff, the existence of which nobody is really sure about. The exterior of the 10-meter-tall tank is draped with a giant photo of its interior, printed on tarpaulin, giving the impression that the tank too is transparent. The tank contains 700,000 liters of water, suspended in which is the detector itself. The detector is another container of sorts, filled with just over 8 tons of ultra-pure and ultra-cool liquid xenon. At the top and bottom ends of the container are plates to which are affixed hundreds of sensitive photomultiplier tubes, on the lookout for the faint and brief flash of ultraviolet light emitted when a xenon nucleus is hit by a dark matter particle. To increase the chances of detecting the flash, the inner walls of the water tank are clad with Teflon, which has a high UV reflectivity. Great care must be taken to eliminate all particle interactions that might produce a signal similar to that which scientists expect from the collision of a xenon nucleus and a dark matter particle. Even 1,400 meters of solid rock is insufficient to stop each and every cosmic ray muon. One out of every million penetrates to this great depth. When muons occasionally interact with the surrounding rock, neutrons are produced. These neutrons could easily disturb the experiment because they too slam into xenon nuclei to produce flashes of UV light, mimicking the expected behavior of dark matter particles. That's one of the reasons why the instrument is placed inside a large tank of purified water. Water is an efficient absorber of neutrons. Then there's natural radioactivity, where heavy nuclei gradually decay into lighter ones, emitting alpha particles, electrons, and energetic gamma-ray photons in the process. All of those decay products create background noise in the measurements. The welding seams of the xenon vessel continuously leak radioactive radon atoms. Traces of radioactive krypton are found literally everywhere on our planet, since we decided to test and deploy nuclear weapons. And commercially bought xenon always contains minute amounts of radioactive tritium. To minimize the unwanted effects of these contaminants, the liquid xenon is continuously purified by the huge distillation column in the transparent building next to the tank. The idea for the detection technique, you'll hear more about the nitty-gritty details in Chapter 18, dates back to the late 20th century. The Xenon Project was started in 2001 by Elena Aprile, an Italian-born physicist at Columbia University and quite a character, according to Colline. The ever-growing international collaboration has built a succession of larger and larger detectors, from the first 3-kilogram prototype to the current 8-ton behemoth, increasing the sensitivity of the experiment with every step. Abrile is still in charge. Colline also tells me about Xenon NT's big competitor, a similar experiment called Lux Zeppelin, underway at the Sanford Underground Research Facility in South Dakota. The leader of the project, Brown University physicist Richard Getzkill, teamed up with Abrile on Xenon for a number of years, but in 2007 the collaboration fell apart. Most of the U.S. groups involved in Xenon decided to join Getzkill in developing their own detector. And then there's Panda X, a large Xenon-based dark matter experiment in China's Jinping Underground Laboratory, another contender in the effort to directly detect dark matter. Despite decades of null results, and despite the alienating atmosphere of the place, the visit to the Laboratori Nazionale di Gran Sasso feels inspiring and energizing. Here, and at the few other laboratories like it, brilliant physicists are employing the most sensitive instruments humankind has ever built in order to explore what they believe is the most abundant, yet most mysterious constituent of the universe. The dedication of these researchers is impressive. Their confidence is contagious. Of course, we're on the verge of making the breakthrough discovery. If not with Xenon NT or its competitors, then probably with one of the other smaller dark matter experiments at Gran Sasso, with names like Darkside, Crest, Dama, and Cosinus. If only this stubborn particle would choose to reveal itself, however briefly, by leaving a diminutive but detectable mark on our high-tech equipment. Or might it be a phantom chase after all? Could it be that all our efforts are futile? Are we doomed to fail, either because no detector could ever isolate the elusive particle, or because the particle doesn't actually exist? Our day at Gran Sasso is over, and as we walk to the car and then drive out of the tunnel into the sunlight, I ask Colline for his thoughts on the doom scenario, on the frustration of dark matter physics. What if you've been on a wild goose chase for your whole career? Surprisingly, Colline is not flustered by the prospect of failure. For one thing, he's not certain about the existence of dark matter, hasn't chosen a side. "I'll only believe it when I see it," he says. What drives Colline is not really a desire to discover the dark matter particle. Rather, he is interested in the technical challenge of the experiment itself. The opportunity to help build an incredibly silent instrument, free of every conceivable form of external or internal noise. Constructing detectors like Xenon NT will benefit science whatever the results, he says. A new generation of physicists is learning to go to the limit and then push the boundaries from there. His highest reward? The joy of working with a great team. That evening, I have dinner with Colline and six of his team members, including Junji Naganoma, at a place called Arustacini Divini on L'Aquila's Via Castello, close to what's left of the medieval Chiesa di Santa Maria Paganica. We enjoy Genziana liqueur, traditional Abruzzese lamb skewers, and local Montepulciano wine. More than 10 years after the devastating earthquake, most of the tile-roofed buildings in the tormented city center are still uninhabited, but the bars and restaurants are bustling. The L'Aquilans refuse to give in, determined as they are to overcome even the largest crisis. Likewise, the young men and women at the table, to me they seem like boys and girls, really, are determined to face every challenge and overcome any setback on their scientific quest for the answer to one of the greatest riddles nature has yet presented. They weren't even born when astronomers found the first strong evidence for the existence of dark matter, back in the 1970s. Hopefully, they will live to celebrate the unfolding of the mystery. The pioneers of the field weren't that lucky. 3. The Pioneers. Jacobus Cornelis Kapteyn died on June 18, 1922. The same year in which he introduced the notion that dark matter could be a necessary feature of the structure and dynamics of the universe. Jan Hendrik Oort died on November 5, 1992.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.